Weidenfeld and Nicholson presents Reed Hastings, Building Netflix, by Matt Burgess. Read by Ian Porter. Chapter 1. Can anyone beat Reed Hastings? The moment modern television changed forever can be traced back to one individual day. Tuesday, 16 January 2007. The reasonably sized DVD rental website Netflix, which had gathered around 5 million subscribers in almost a decade of business, launched a bold new service to its members. Following in the footsteps of YouTube, Netflix would start beaming video directly to people's computers. But unlike the Google-owned YouTube, the company would stream movies and television shows to PCs, building on its DVD business. Everything was quality content. Shaky, handheld, homemade cat videos were not included. For the first time in 100 years of television history, it was possible for viewers to pick what they wanted to see and watch it at the exact moment they desired. There would be no lengthy hours spent waiting for a movie to download. It could be streamed instantly. A strict TV schedule detailing when a show would broadcast no longer governed the lives of consumers, nor would they need to program a VHS recorder if they were going to be out at the time a new episode aired. With one swift move, Netflix handed the power of television viewing from powerful networks and media conglomerates to the individual. It offered the ultimate flexibility in consumer convenience. Suddenly, it was possible to binge-watch every episode of an entire series back-to-back. And importantly for Reed Hastings, the charismatic CEO and co-founder of Netflix, it gave his company a distinct advantage over the competition. The service wasn't perfect by any means. There were only several hundred shows that could be watched over the internet to begin with. The quality was relatively poor, high-speed internet connections were a necessity, and viewing was limited to PCs. Hardly an ideal position to watch a two-hour-long film. But 6 months later, Netflix subscribers in the U.S. had watched movies and TV episodes through their computers 5 million times. An internet television revolution had been started, and the traditional powers within the industry were left flat-footed. Since then, they have been unable to match Netflix's technological offering and lost serious ground to the Californian company. When Netflix moved into producing its own movies and TV shows 5 years later, it similarly upended Hollywood. The company's huge checkbook has allowed it to lavishly buy top talent to star in its shows and hoover up unsigned productions that it has branded as its own. In the process, it has won almost every single industry award possible. Within a few short years, the company has amassed more than 150 million subscribers and is the streaming firm that everyone wants to beat. Now competitors are scrambling to offer their own rival services and draw in their own subscribers. The big question is, can anyone beat Hastings? Over the last 20 years, Hastings has grown Netflix into one of the internet's most dominant companies. From humble beginnings in a former bank, it has grown to more than 5,000 employees spread across global offices, including Hollywood, Los Angeles, London, Amsterdam, Paris, Mexico City, and Tokyo. On a single day at the start of 2018, people around the world watched more than 350 million hours of movies, TV shows, and documentaries on his platform. Yet Netflix isn't a new phenomenon. Hastings started the business in 1997 after successfully launching, and subsequently selling, a software development company as part of a deal originally valued at $890 million. When Hastings founded Netflix, many of the technological behemoths that dominate online life today hadn't even been dreamed of. Google launched a year after Netflix. It took another decade before the first iPhone was released. Mark Zuckerberg was just entering his teenage years and half a decade away from launching Facebook, 2004, from his Harvard dorm room. Twitter didn't start until 2006, and Uber wasn't founded until 2009. Netflix started out as an online seller of DVDs and a postal rental service, a business that's radically different to what it is today. But at its core is a simple idea: provide people with entertainment and take up their time on a quiet evening or weekend afternoon. Currently, this takes place in the format of movies, documentaries, and TV series being streamed across the internet to televisions, laptops, tablets, and smartphones. It used to be solely through DVDs. Since 2007, streaming technology has allowed Netflix customers to pick what they watch, when they watch it, and how they watch it. And the service is almost universal. Netflix streams to more than 190 countries around the world, with operations missing from only a few. It's not available in China, not through lack of trying, the Republic of Crimea in Russia, North Korea, or Syria. In July 2019, Netflix had amassed 151 million subscribers who pay to access its shows and help it to revenues of $4.5 billion every 3 months. There are no ads on the service, and more than half of its subscribers live outside the United States. Since its earliest days, Netflix has operated a subscription model whereby customers pay a small amount every month to access video. At the beginning, the subscription prices put limits on the number of discs that could be rented at one time. If you were willing to pay for it, you could rent an unlimited number of DVDs in a month. Now Netflix doesn't set limits to how much a person can watch. It wants them to spend as much time as possible in its apps and viewing its shows. Data limits set by mobile service providers may dictate certain restrictions, though. If you want to watch a stand-up comedy gig at 4 o'clock in the morning, or blast your way through a 12-episode series in one sitting, then you can. During the late 2000s, the company's popularity saw the creation of the Netflix and chill meme. The phrase became a synonym for inviting a date to a person's house, with the underlying assumption that sex could be likely. Since 2012, Netflix's business model has evolved from a service that just operates over the internet to one that makes its own video content. It's now no longer a company that solely purchases movies and TV shows from studios. Netflix's catalog of shows is dominated by its originals, productions it has purchased the rights to exclusively, or in a growing number of cases, produced itself. The second Netflix original, House of Cards, starring Kevin Spacey, cost Netflix around $100 million per series. And by 2018, its overall budget for content had risen to a colossal $12 billion. And reports claimed it would have more than 1,000 originals by the start of 2019. The movies and TV series are made in multiple countries around the world, and its shows have seen it scoop up nominations and wins in the Golden Globes, Emmy Awards, and the Oscars. For the first time in Netflix's history, in 2018, it was nominated for more Emmy Awards than HBO, and in January 2019, it received its first Oscar nomination for the coveted Best Picture Award. The title Roma ultimately did not win. At the center of all of Netflix's success has been Hastings. The thoughtful leader has sat at the helm since the business's second year of operations. Initially an engineer who started and sold a software debugging business, Hastings has had to learn how to effectively manage people and grow a company to a global scale. Hastings has interests in politics and has been an education philanthropist for more than a decade, donating hundreds of millions of dollars to businesses and charities. Yet, he is fairly private. His personal and family life are rarely talked about in the press, let alone by him. After decades taking questions from the press, he is now incredibly media polished, although he can be vociferous in his criticism of competitors and politicians he does not agree with. He's battled with Hollywood, legislators, TV executives, and their production studios, plus an ever-growing list of rivals. His former employees credit him with honesty, intelligence, and an eagerness to learn, and describe him as a person who values disagreement. They say he takes an analytical approach to decisions, can focus on data, and has the foresight to see future problems before they have arrived. Even during the early DVD-only days of Netflix, Hastings talked about the company's future in downloads and streaming. People spoken to in the reporting for this book say Hastings will often ask them detailed questions about their work that they haven't even considered, despite working on projects for months at a time. He is often one step ahead of all those around him. Conversely, they say he can often appear to lack empathy and is highly competitive. During the two decades of Netflix, Hastings and colleagues have struck crucial deals with movie studios, TV broadcasters, and hardware firms to promote the company, crucially getting the service in front of more potential subscribers. Some of its shows now get viewerships of tens of millions of people. The dream 20 years from now, Hastings told Wired magazine back in 2002, is to have a global entertainment distribution company that provides a unique channel for film producers and studios. That was achieved before the deadline, but it hasn't exactly been a smooth process, with fears for Netflix's survival being a possibility more than once. His biggest mistake came when he attempted to split the business into two in 2011, one purely handling streaming and another to deliver DVDs. There was outrage. The split followed a huge 60% price hike for subscribers, and just months after announcing the change, Netflix abandoned the idea. In total, 800,000 subscribers deserted the company, and its stock dropped more than 50%. Unlike Google, Facebook, and Twitter, Netflix has seen very few public controversies. Foreign governments haven't been accused of infiltrating its systems, and its lack of advertisements means the data it collects about users is more limited than that gathered by its rivals. That's not to say it hasn't suffered privacy scandals. It canceled a competition designed for members of the public to improve its recommendation algorithms after it became possible for people to be identified, and it faces regulators around the world that look to control or censor its shows. Like all of Hollywood, some of the actors its productions have employed have been accused of sexual harassment or abuse of people they have worked with, the most well-known of whom is Kevin Spacey. It was reported dropping Spacey's projects cost Netflix $39 million, as a toxic culture reigned supreme across the movie business. Perhaps Hastings' biggest success at Netflix has been being able to ensure the company has survived. Its stock has consistently fluctuated as investors have speculated on which competitor may knock it out of business. During the mid-2000s, Netflix fought an intense price war with Blockbuster as it looked to convert its failing physical rental stores into a flourishing digital business and catch up with Hastings' lead. While Netflix beat Blockbuster, the streaming age has introduced new competitors. Amazon has its Prime Video service. Disney has Disney Plus and is in the process pulling its content from Netflix. Apple has its TV Plus service. YouTube is increasingly moving towards highly produced programmatic videos. And there is the omnipresent threat of Hulu and HBO. Each of these competitors has prompted analysts to seriously question whether Netflix can survive in an increasingly saturated digital environment. And as a result, its stock has seen occasional short-term dips in value. But for the time being, at least, Hastings does not see any of them as his major competition. He believes there's a place for multiple streaming companies, and what will stop them all from growing is customers spending time on other activities that aren't sitting in front of a screen. You know, think about it. When you watch a show from Netflix and you get addicted to it, you stay up late at night. he told investors on an earnings call in April 2017. We're competing with sleep on the margin, and so it's a very large pool of time. Chapter 2. Reed Hastings, Jr. Wilmot Reed Hastings, Jr. was born on 8 October 1960 in Massachusetts, United States. As the son of Joan Amory and Wilmot Reed Hastings, he grew up in the relatively well-off neighborhood of Belmont, a suburb that's around a 30-minute drive from the state's capital city, Boston. His father served as a lawyer for the U.S. government, working for the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare during the Nixon administration. But his mother's side of the family has a history of technology, innovation, and engineering that would ultimately trickle down to the Netflix co-founder. His great-grandfather was the inventor and scientist Alfred Lee Loomis. When he died, age 87, in 1975, the New York Times called him a renowned physicist. Loomis is credited with helping to develop techniques for electroencephalography, EEG, which is used for brain scans, and the long-range navigation system, LORAN, which was used by the United States in the Second World War. He also worked as a lawyer and helped to found the research group, the RAND Corporation. Hastings lives in Santa Cruz with his wife, Patty Ann Quillen, and the pair have two children. The family has kept a number of pets over the years, owning at one point 4 shelter dogs, 10 chickens, and 4 goats, including Nigerian dwarf goats, a type of goat that's relatively easy to keep as a pet and pretty small in stature. For most of his professional life, Hastings has sported a graying goatee and had a laid-back demeanor, and in public appearances usually wears dark jeans, a shirt, and a suit jacket. In the early days of Netflix, he was often found in khaki shorts, sandals, and t-shirts, the uniform of Silicon Valley. When speaking publicly and to the press, Hastings is generally open. He attempts to answer most questions that are directed at him in a way that seems to be honest. The answers he gives to questions can take 2 forms. He repeats the line of questioning before answering, or he can use a number of go-to anecdotes that have been repeated multiple times. In keeping with this, his personal life is largely kept private. In 2014, he told The New Yorker he wasn't that exciting, either out of a desire to keep it completely quiet, or because it genuinely is the case. "Unfortunately, and weirdly, I have almost no hobbies," Hastings told the publication. "I don't sail, I don't fish. I'm a pitiful failure as a Renaissance man." In 2012, he admitted to Vanity Fair magazine that he doesn't particularly enjoy being a figurehead in public life. He'd rather largely remain private. "It's an appropriate and necessary sacrifice," he said. "But on a personal basis, it's pure downside, because then you just get more recognized. You lead a less normal life. I hate the photo shoots. I hate all that stuff." Despite the professional necessity of his having a public profile, it's unlikely many people would recognize Hastings in the same way Mark Zuckerberg is known. Hastings entered the Forbes list of the top 400 wealthiest people in the U.S., all of them billionaires, for the first time in 2017. A year later, he had climbed from around 350th to 215th on the list. And with Netflix's strong financial performance, it's likely he will climb even higher. As of April 2019, Bloomberg's Billionaires Index list places Hastings at 427 and says his $4.57 billion net worth could buy 63.8 million barrels of crude oil. Although he has been a billionaire for some time now, Hastings generally isn't a flashy man. He doesn't overtly, unlike some other tech billionaires, show his wealth and status. He learned a valuable lesson early on in his career. After selling his first company, Hastings took part in an interview with the newspaper USA Today for an article on the ever-increasing number of millionaires in Silicon Valley. The subsequent write-up resulted in a picture of Hastings lounging on the bonnet of his brand-new Porsche Carrera being splashed on the front page of the paper. The caption? Boom! You are rich! He went to Buckingham Brown and Nichols School, which is not far from Belmont or Harvard University. The establishment is a private school whose roots go back to the late 1800s. Hastings graduated in 1978, 4 years after it became mixed sex. He was interested in going to college and ended up at the liberal arts establishment Bowdoin, 100 miles north of Boston on the East Coast. But he didn't rush straight into his maths major at the college, and instead took a year out to continue working in his first job of selling rainbow vacuum cleaners door-to-door around Boston. In a 2015 talk, he said the experience was a fantastic introduction to selling. He also said he loved the job, as he met plenty of different people. As a sales pitch, I cleaned the carpet with the vacuum the customer had, and then cleaned it with the rainbow, he said in a New York Times column, The Boss, in 2006. The early selling experience didn't stop him attending Bowdoin and getting his bachelor's degree. During his time at the college, he excelled in maths, something that would later be useful during the development of artificial intelligence systems. Bill Barker, one of Hastings' former teachers, told the college university newspaper that Hastings had confidence without arrogance. At the college, Hastings ran the Outing Club, an adventure and outdoors club for which he organized climbing and canoeing trips, among other activities. Before he graduated from Bowdoin in 1983, Hastings spent a semester at the University of Bath in the UK, and another summer training at a Marine Corps boot camp. He had intended to go into the service, but the summer was a misplaced one. He wasn't suited to a regimented and disciplined life in the Marines, he told an education publication in 2015. I'm not good at following orders. Instead, he opted for the softer Peace Corps, a voluntary program run by the U.S. government that's designed to help provide social and economic support to other countries. Here, Hastings was assigned to a teaching job. He spent 3 years teaching maths in Eswatini, which was known as Swaziland at the time. During his time in the country, Hastings enjoyed the lifestyle and culture change. He experienced the outdoors and made the most of being able to travel through the country's vast landscapes. Not forgetting his old mathematics teacher, Bill Barker, Hastings wrote letters to him while he was there. Details of these were reported by the Bowdoin Orient student newspaper years later. The first year, I loved, he wrote. Hastings said he lived with a family around 3 kilometers from the school he taught at and walked to and from work. The second year, I lived at the school with the other teachers and spent my afternoons playing cards and drinking beer. In other letters, he is said to have written that he didn't feel particularly challenged by the time he was spending there. I would never dribble away my days at home like this, he is said to have written. The student newspaper wrote that his innovative flair first started to show itself during these slower periods. The answer to my boredom and my underutilization was to get involved with the community as a whole instead of limiting myself to the school compound. He started to create a plan to build a tank on top of the village's hill so rainwater could be collected where it was needed. And he also requested money from the United States so people could start beekeeping. After being granted the money, Hastings helped to teach courses on building beehives and looking after the insects, the student newspaper wrote. It was during this time that Hastings started to consider what he would do next. I didn't want to be a math professor. It seemed just too dry, he said during a 2015 talk at an investment firm, Kleiner Perkins Caulfield and Byers. Instead, after around 3 years in Africa, he settled on studying on a course involving a huge maths element, but also one that incorporated computers. During the early 1980s, the field of artificial intelligence was going through its second boom. After emerging during the 1960s, the principles of using algorithms to solve computer problems had died away. A lack of processing power limited its progress. But by the time Hastings was mulling over his future, there was a renewed faith in AI with the development of the expert system. The programs were designed to use a large base of knowledge to find answers to potential real-world problems. During the decade, the systems became hugely popular within universities and at large Fortune 500 companies that wanted to take advantage of computer-aided decisions. Hastings joined this boom and applied to study at the renowned Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT, just a few miles from the Boston suburbs where he had grown up. He also applied to the West Coast's Stanford University. It's not a huge surprise because I didn't have any computer science background, but I didn't get into MIT, he said in the 2015 talk. However, Stanford did let him onto its course. The trip to Stanford was the first time Hastings had ever traveled to the west of the U.S. He called himself naive to the state's laid-back culture and straightforward way of life. He told the New York Times, "Driving up to the campus, I saw palm trees. It was dry and brown. I asked myself, where's the ivy?" Within a week, I had fallen in love with California. The Stanford AI course was the start of his time in technology, and Hastings relished it. "When I came back from Eswatini, I really got into computers," he told the technology website The Next Web in 2013. "At Stanford, in the AI program, and for the next couple of years, I just programmed, and it was just such a joy I couldn't even imagine doing this as a job as opposed to a hobby. It was just such a joy to develop things." From this point, his future in technology was almost assured. He briefly dabbled in politics before Netflix, but a spark for entrepreneurialism had been created. He thrived on competition and creating new products that people could use. After graduating from Stanford in 1988, Hastings bounced around between a few different roles, evidently struggling to find the exact satisfaction and calling he wanted. First, he worked in the research division of the oil field giant Schlumberger, and then moved to an artificial intelligence startup, Coherent Thought, which suffered the ill fate of the 1980s AI bubble bursting. Things started to change for Hastings when he joined Adaptive Technology. The company, founded by the entrepreneur and investor Audrey McLean, was spun out from and later merged with Network Equipment Technologies and built high-speed switches for computer networks. Hastings was employed as a software engineer, and it was here he formed the idea for his first business. Bugs in the Code. Raymond Peck first met Reed Hastings at a party and didn't know what it would lead to. Sometime in the late 1980s, Peck's girlfriend was working at Coherent Thought, the same artificial intelligence startup where Hastings was a software engineer. Through the company's weekly Friday beer bashes, Peck, an engineer by trade, started to get to know Hastings. He was a very happy guy, not goofy, kind of reserved, but very cordial and warm, Peck recalls during a Skype conversation. "Not at all your stereotypical software guy. He had a lot of charisma even at that time. He just had a lot of magnetism to him." Even though it was the first time they had met, Peck knew of Hastings before they started to share beers. He was at Stanford at the same time as Hastings, but on a different course. Peck says he was responsible for grading some basic programming language class papers at Stanford. In only one of the 100 papers he marked one year did the author really know what they were talking about. It was Hastings. He was already impressed by his knowledge. It was at the Friday afternoon company parties when the two of them started talking about Hastings' idea for a new software tool called Purify. Hastings was looking for someone who could help write the underlying code to make Purify work, and it was exactly the sort of job that Peck knew how to do. In the summer of 91, we started working on it together, Peck says. He had the code partially working, kind of handed it over to me, and he disappeared off to Europe for the summer. Over the next 6 months, the pair worked on the code together, with Peck eventually deciding to quit his full-time job to work for the newly formed company, Pure Software.
Pure Software. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.